deep fakes are getting harder to detect, and that's a real problem. Using artificial intelligence, people can make videos or audio of real people appearing to say things they've never said, sort of a Photoshop on steroids. It's literally putting words in somebody's mouth. It's not hard to imagine how this could be misused, like this video of former President Barack Obama appearing to insult President Donald Trump.
President Trump is a total and complete Now, you see, I would never say these things, but someone else would. Someone like Jordan Peele.
That's director Jordan Peele showing us just how easy it is to manipulate what you see. Republican and Democratic lawmakers think deepfakes could become the latest weapon in the disinformation wars against the United States. Marianne Franks is a law professor at the University of Miami. She runs the Cyber Civil Rights Initiative. It's so nice to see you. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you so much for having me.
Of course. So give me the definition of a deepfake, and how is that different from a doctored video, which I think most people are pretty familiar with?
Right. So a deepfake is an audio or visual depiction that has been digitally manipulated so that it appears that a person is saying or doing something that they did not, in fact, say or do. And it's a little different from a doctored video because what's actually at issue is this underlying machine learning or algorithmic sort of learning that is going into the person's facial expressions, and it makes it seem much more authentic than a doctored video.
The Nancy Pelosi doctored video, I think for a lot of people, it wasn't really particularly well doctored. It was called kind of a fake pretty fast. I was surprised that Facebook didn't take it down. And even the little blurb they wrote about it was not super committal to, like, this is a fake, this is a doctored video. What are your biggest concerns as the quality gets better of the fakes? Deep fakes are just really, really convincing.
They really are, and that's the major concern, that even if you have responsible actions being taken in the wake of a deep fake, and the Pelosi video was not even that, right? The Pelosi video is just a slowed down video that gives a false impression. But even when you have those kinds of videos that maybe quickly might be debunked or called out for what they actually are, the problem is by the time people see that in the first instance, it's going to make an impact on them. There's this fairly well-documented effect called the illusory truth effect, which means that even when we see something and know that it's false, or even we're being told that it's false, the fact that we keep seeing it makes us believe in some part of our brains that it is true. And that effect is almost impossible to undo.
How risky is this for your average person, who's not, say, Speaker of the House, but just a regular person, that a deep fake could be problematic for them?
Well, it's interesting because I think the reason that we're seeing so much attention being paid to the issue now, it's not because this hasn't been a problem before. It's because people are realizing that it might affect others. And now what we're seeing is the average victim of this is probably more likely to be someone who is someone's ex-girlfriend or someone who has, for whatever reason, inspired the resentment maybe of someone who wants to create, probably in some very sexual way, a deep fake of them.
I was going to ask, when you started saying ex-girlfriend and things like that, I'm thinking, yeah. Oh, so you're talking about creating revenge porn that's fake, but that looks incredibly real and destroys somebody's life.
Exactly.
What are the risks, do you think, when you focus on politics?
I think the risk is that we're not understanding how it is that we keep ending up in the same place when it comes to these kinds of problems. Online abuses, technological abuses, all of them pretty much will happen to the most vulnerable members of our community first. And usually that's women or people of color. And what happens in every instance is we don't pay attention to it until it actually does affect something like politics or it affects national security. And then we realize it's too late for us to really do very much about it, or we're very much behind. And the lesson that we keep, it's for some reason not learning, is that we should care when it happens to women. We should care when it happens to people of color. And if we did, we might have built better products. We might have regulated social media maybe in a slightly different way so that we wouldn't have had this problem to begin with.
Marianne Franks from the University of Miami. Nice to see you. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.